As we have seen in previous videos, there are several optical and electrical losses that determine the conversion efficiency of a solar cell. How do we take all these losses into account when determining the conversion efficiency of a solar cell? In other words, what is the mathematical expression for the efficiency incorporating all of these loss mechanisms? In this video, we will guide you through this expression and explain every component that represents a particular loss in energy conversion. We have already learned that the efficiency of a solar cell depends on its short circuit current density, open circuit voltage, and fill factor. We also calculated the potential photocurrent density by absorbing the AM 1.5 spectrum for a given band gap. Nevertheless, because of the optical and electrical losses in solar cells, their short circuit current is never equal to the potential photocurrent density. So how can we calculate the maximum practical short circuit current density of a solar cell? For determining the maximum practical short circuit current density of a solar cell, it is necessary to perform an external quantum efficiency or EQE measurement. As you can remember from previous videos, EQE is a measure of the fraction of photons incident on a solar cell that actually contribute to the generation of current. As you can see in this graph, where the EQE and the total reflectance of a solar cell are displayed, both are wavelength dependent. The shape of the EQE curve reflects both optical and electrical losses in the solar cell. We can see that the EQE curve decreases with increasing reflectance. This is logical, because reflectance reduces the possibility of utilizing all photons incident on a solar cell. What further information can the EQE measurement provide us? The EQE quantifies the loss of the photocurrent density due to the combined effect of total reflection, parasitic absorption, and recombination. It can be approximated by this equation. The first term, 1 minus R, represents the fraction of photons that are not reflected from the solar cell and hence enter the solar cell. The second term, IQE OP, is the internal optical quantum efficiency, which is the probability of a photon being absorbed in a material. The third term, eta G, is the quantum efficiency of the generation of charge carriers. It represents the number of electron hole pairs generated by one absorbed photon. This parameter is usually assumed to be 1. It means that an absorbed photon generates 1 electron hole pair. The fourth term, IQE-EL, is the electrical quantum efficiency, which is the probability that a photo-generated carrier is collected. Recombination processes decrease the electrical quantum efficiency. Understanding and quantifying the optical and electrical losses is crucial to enhance the conversion efficiency of a solar cell. Performing optical simulations can provide more insight about the optical and electrical losses in solar cells. The graph illustrates the total reflectance and absorptance of all individual layers of a multicrystalline silicon solar cell. The red line represents the measured EQE of the cell. The white area represents the total reflectance that is one of the major losses. The colored areas between the white area and the red line present the parasitic absorptance within the multicrystalline silicon solar cell. You can see that at short wavelengths, there is significant parasitic absorption in the emitter, which is shown in green. You can see that part of this green curve does contribute to the EQE, but not all of it. In the emitter layer, losses of photogenerated carriers due to recombination occur before their collection. At long wavelengths, photons have an energy close to that of the bandgap. The absorption coefficient becomes small, and as a consequence, the probability that these photons are absorbed is low. Due to this, many photons pass through the absorber layer and are absorbed in the metal back reflector. The absorptance of the metal is shown in gray on this slide. Combining both simulation and the EQE measurement can help us to determine how to improve a solar cell. If there is significant parasitic absorption in short wavelengths, using a thinner emitter may help to get a higher current density. On the other hand, if there are a lot of losses in the long wavelength region, using enhanced light trapping techniques or a thicker absorber may help. Of course, a thinner emitter and a thicker absorber will result in more recombination losses and poorer collection, so trade-offs must always be considered. Once the EQE is obtained, the short circuit current density can be computed by integrating the product of the EQE and the photon flux density. The range to be used is from 300 nanometers to the wavelength corresponding to the bandgap energy, since the AM1.5 spectrum does not contain much radiation below 300 nanometers. In addition, front contact shading losses have to be taken into account. To do so, we multiply the term by the active area coverage factor that we introduced in the previous video. Now, let's put all the loss terms together to get this long equation for the conversion efficiency, eta. The short circuit current density is substituted by the expression we have just derived. Next, by performing additional substitutions and rearrangements, we can arrive to the conversion efficiency in terms of every particular loss in a solar cell. The first term describes the non-absorption of photons with less energy than the bandgap of the absorber material. The second term represents thermalization of excess photon energy for photons of higher energy than the bandgap of the absorber layer. The third term, the coverage factor, determines the shading losses due to the coverage of front contact electrodes. The fourth term describes the fraction of photons that are absorbed in the solar cell. These are photons that are not reflected. The fifth term represents an incomplete absorption due to a finite thickness of the absorber layer. The sixth term includes recombination losses. The seventh term takes the utilization of the bandgap energy into account. This term is often called the voltage factor. And the last term is the fill factor. In this video, we have presented a mathematical expression for solar cell conversion efficiency. This expression includes terms that take all the losses into account that we have discussed before. Now you can have a better understanding of how they together influence the performance of the solar cell and decrease its efficiency.